Good afternoon. I have a pleasure to introduce a guest lecturer in today's seminar in stochastics. Artur Sepp has come from London, Bank of America. Merrill Lynch is his current workplace. And Artur is our graduate. He did here at Tartu University two master degrees in 2003. He defended two degrees in one day. And and 4 years later, in 2007, he defended his PhD degree also here in Tartu. But meanwhile, he has also studied in the United States for 2 or 3 years in Purdue University, Northwestern University. And in being in the United States, he first joined Stearns, big investment bank, after a very successful internship. And he was offered a job in the bank, and some time later he joined Bank of America, Merrill Lynch. Artur is well-known expert in quantitative finance, and he publishes research papers, which is not very usual for people working in banks, and he's also active in conference participation. So today Artur will speak about the problem he has been tackled with in his everyday work, and he demonstrates how mathematical and statistical methods can be used to solve problems in a big investment bank. So Artur Sepp.
Thank you, Kolya, for a nice introduction. And it is my privilege to be back here after some years and present something that partially I learned here and something that I do at my work, not at every day, because it's very narrow focus probably. But something that I want to kind of like talk not only about mathematics, but only how you connect models to data, how you visualize and how you draw conclusions, and how you apply kind of theoretical tools to justify what you do. And so in one of particular the topics I was working recently is how to optimize capital of the company, how to pay dividends, how to issue new debt, and I will be talking about like quantitative methods how to achieve these goals. So in particular, I will present estimation of regime switching model, and then I will apply this model for a structural default problem, and then I will do some kind of theoretical approach. I will develop a theoretical approach based on rendezvous state prices and show how to apply this for valuation of different defaultable securities on firm debt. And then finally, I will present econometric estimation of this model using joint dynamics of stock price and credit default swap spreads. And while first two topics have been covered in the literature, the last two are original research. So, and I start with a little bit of background. So the classic structural Milton model states that the firm will default when the firm value will cross through its liabilities. And in context of this is something that is no structural model, and I will show some specific illustrations of this. And then later, Leon thought they considered problem of optimization the firm capital by solving it mathematically, with control being the kind of what is the optimal level of the firm value that the firm should bankrupt and how much they should pay the coupon on their own debt. What is it? And this is nice theoretical arguments, but in practice the management does not control over the firm default. And I know it too well because of working during global financial crisis. And what is more, there is also Gerald Turnbull model assumes that the default may not solely depend on the firm value. There can be external circumstances where the firm can default. And my goal is to present like combined structural reduced form model and apply it for modeling, kind of reproducing empirical data and then drawing conclusions out of this kind of calibrated model. So why do I choose regime switching model? I looked at different models for econometrical modeling of time series. And this is something that if we believe to Sherlock Holmes, it's a capital mistake to theorize before one has the data. It's very important. Like, just you need to look at the data first, try to draw conclusions, and then apply the model. This is very important. You don't want to fit solution to your model. Otherwise, you want to find some practical application and fit a model. So if you look at I have like a time series of S&P 500 index for last 15 years. And we can easily spot the periods. So this is the absolute value of S&P 500 index. This is a figure is realized volatility of monthly returns on the S&P 500 index. And we can clearly spot the periods of bear and bull markets. So in bear markets, we can spot the negative trend accompanied by high volatility. And in opposite, in bull markets, we have periods of positive drift accompanied by low volatility. And in opposite, during like here's like global financial crisis was very strong negative drift accompanied by very strong volatility. And interesting picture also arises when we look at frequency, at Kugel plot of realized returns. So this is a monthly return on the S&P 500 index for last 15 years. So basically, and we are comparing against normal quantiles. So basically, the discrepancies here indicate that returns are far from being log normal. Whereas if we take each monthly return, we compute realized volatility of daily return with this month, and we consider the normalized return normalized by volatility, then it becomes normal. And based on Anderson-Darling test, we come strong presumption against normality of returns here, but we cannot reject that actually volatility normalized returns are normal. What it says that the departure from normality can be caused by changes in volatility. And we have also the same picture for individual stocks. So, for example, here is I have like one financial stock, also the same time interval, so we can easily spot the period of kind of strong positive drift accompanied by extreme loss of 92% within like few months. And then again, and this fall was accompanied by very strong volatility. And if we again we do like this, now we look at the frequency of monthly returns, we can easily spot departure from normality. Basically, we observe returns of -70%, -50% within 1 month. Yes. So, and also kind of heavy tails. But once we normalize returns by realized volatility, the data becomes more closer to normal, as we see in this figure. And we again, we have strong presumption against the hypothesis that returns are normal, but we cannot reject hypothesis that normalized returns are normal. So, and the way to model it mathematically is to introduce kind of regime switching model. The model includes two states. So, state zero will indicate that the market is in normal state, and where we observe positive drift and volatility and like small volatility. And state one will correspond to kind of stress state with negative mean and like large volatility. And our return process, so this will be x, will be log normal return on the index or on the stock. And we assume that it has changing parameters. So variable L is kind of state indicator. It will be switching between 0 and 1. And the transition is modeled by Markov chain with this kind of generator matrix. And so, and also we added jumps. So basically, when we have transition from kind of goods from normal state to stressed state, the variable will jump, M will jump to 1, and it means that the parameters will change from normal to stressed parameters. Plus, the log return will experience jump, which is a negative exponential. And in opposite, when we return from stressed state to normal state, we will have positive jump, and we change parameters, it will change from stressed to normal state. And transition, we have corresponding transitions. So lambda zero means transition to bad state, lambda one means transition back to state, to normal state. So once we have this kind of stochastic model, the next question is how do we calibrate it to time series? And for this purpose, I apply the filtering approach of Hamilton. So originally it was developed to model econometric data, to model time series of econometric data. And it was widespread in economics and partially in finance. So here we have y is our observed variable log return, and m is a hidden variable. We don't know. It's kind of model assumption. We assume that we have this kind of indicator. It's fine. But we cannot observe it from the market. We have to infer it from the data. To infer, we use this filtering procedure. So it basically is based on the application of Bayesian inference. So for that, we need to specify what is my kind of this F. It will depend on what I'm saying, that what will be a distribution of returns when I'm in state zero, like here. So I have two conditions here. Is I need to observe. Maybe it's better to draw graph. So M is a state variable. So it go. So from zero normal, it goes to state one, which will be like a stress regime. Then it goes back to two. So it's like this. It jumps. So jumping times are exponential. So the intensity of going from state 0 to state 1 is 0, lambda 0, and return back to state 1. And the basic equation is basically says, okay, this is like what my inference. Like basically, I want to infer what is my probability of M, that of M e plus 1, if I observe the data at y e plus 1. And I observe data, I know already kind of I put an initial condition for this kind of state indicator. And I go and basically this will be just application of my kind of conditional something like this. So I always this one I observe, so I can so say within 1 month I observe the return. The only unknown is what is the state. But this will be I know this function. They correspond to the model, what I assume, what it is. Assuming that I know what is the state, I'm saying that returns abnormal. If I had, if there was crossing, like I know that I jump from kind of from say good regime to bad regime, then I'm adding exponential jump. So it's everything here is, but it's all analytic. And I need to multiply by my kind of transition probabilities, which I have here, these are determined by intensity of this state. So it's kind of nothing more but application of Bayesian inference. So I have it right here. So obviously, because we have like kind of we have four possibilities, because we experience jump only first time that we go to stress test, right? So the jump only occurs if we have sequence like this. So I start in period MP. So jump occurs only here. If I have sequence like I'm still in kind of in say I'm already in regime one, then the return are just normal, right? I am adding jump only in first case when it was for the first time. And so here is kind of the algorithm. It's like two lines. And then obviously we have conditional maximum likelihood, so we maximize the likelihood over the parameters. And I returned it to the minimum of parameters in a little bit. And then also what is important, like you study people that study statistics, they know it's not just enough to say I have parameters like this, so everyone is happy. It's not. You need to find how much confidence I have about these estimated parameters given my data. And because here it's obviously it's you need to understand that this is financial data. It has non-stationarity. Stress returns are very rare to observe. What do we mean stress returns? It's like 2008 European crisis. Here obviously it depends on estimation windows. Right. So, say I would, if I were using it or kind of say I was presented something like that, and people would say, okay, I have some kind of asymptotic estimates for these parameters. Obviously, it's not true. I mean, it's very hard to justify it. So why I like this kind of bootstrap idea to implement kind of bootstrap? And bootstrap is basically is it's based on the following observation that even kind of sample, we just basically, why we cannot build normal convergence bounds, because we don't observe, we don't have enough data. So Bootstrap gives you the way to compute artificial data based on the data that you already observed. So by original Bootstrap method, it's just you take from observed sample, you take some kind of choices with replacement, you construct some kind of artificial data, and then you apply your simulators to this kind of Bootstrap data, and you see what the parameter, estimated parameters turn out for this data, and then you have range for each Bootstrap scenario, you have kind of sample of estimated model parameters, and then you how it's stable, how the, your estimation is stable. And obviously this assumes that data is identical. Otherwise, if data is serially correlated, you destroy the structure of data. So why there is this kind of moving block Bootstrap, which basically, again, it's like, if I say I have time series, so it's like T0, say I have like T10, and like T100, so T20. So basically, block Bootstrap, say, instead of picking like keys individually here by one day, I'm just picking the block. Picking the blocks of data, and I'm constructing artificial time series with the same length. And in this way, I preserve the correlation within this kind of sample, within the blocks. And then the method that I like is stationary Bootstrap. It's basically saying that instead of keeping block sizes fixed, I assume they are random. So they kind of have a geometric distribution. And based on some kind of theoretical analysis, it turns out that kind of I preserve the stationarity of my data. Meaning that within my sample data, I preserve the stationarity of original data. And here I have some estimate for parameters of S&P 500 index, and I'm also applying the Bootstrap method to compute a standard deviation of my parameter estimates and 5% quantiles. So the most interesting, obviously, is a lot of numbers, but the most interesting here is like, so this is the normal drift and stress drift. We confirm our kind of visual evidence that periods of different drifts are present in data. So for normal state, we observe a return of 15%. For stress regime, we observe return of minus 30%. And so what else? And obviously, it's why it, we see that while our estimation for kind of normal periods, it's kind of stable, it has smaller volatility, while returns for a stress regime can be very big, like from minus 100% almost to minus 10. And basically, it depends within each sample how many bad data I sample. So say I have within one sample, say maybe I have 3 global financial crises, then obviously it's like I get like something minus 10%. It basically is saying you like if the history repeats itself, say, and but instead of say within 10 years I'm going to experience like 3 global financial crises, then this is kind of I better to assume like kind of minus 100% drift. So it's very important, the point what I'm trying to make, that it's very hard to infer probability and statistics of stressed regimes. And for this purpose, I only have 7 parameters. So instead, so I have only like intensity to go to state zero, to stressed regime, is about 20. It means that I expect one crisis within like every 5 years. And basically the length of the, like, and again, it's properties of like stationary Markov chain, that basically what is my length of period that I expected to be in that crisis is basically, so probability of stressed regime, it will be probability that I go something like this, I'm fixing, I'm saying, okay, this is 10%, and it's like, it's my, I found out that it's not sensitive, the parameters are not sensitive to this specification, and only the intensities, and it's always best to keep parameters stable rather than over-calibrating the model. Because the final goal is to make predictions, and predictions are as good as stable in your parameter. And then, obviously, one of the output of this filtering approach is a kind of probabilities of being in stress regime. It's again kind of Bayesian inferences based on the fact that we don't really observe the kind of hidden the hidden state variable, so we don't know whether is accurate or not, we only can draw conclusions about its probabilities. So one of the output of this filter, it's a kind of time series of this inferred probability. And it is kind of, so whenever kind of say, I would go to some people to present like model like this, I always would kind of highlight that the model corresponds, model outputs corresponds to intuition about what the financial crisis is. So we obviously say this is, was probability was one when during global financial crisis. Then we had European crisis was probability one. Then it was US sovereign downgrade and some probably European crisis. So it really corresponds to what I think is a stress regime based on just kind of observing returns and volatilities. And so the probability is on the left scale, and obviously S&P 500 is on the right scale. So we see that when model shows that it's likely to be, that we are likely to be in stress regime, obviously index goes down, and the opposite in tranquil periods, probabilities, inferred probability is zero and index goes up. So now, and now also one part of kind of is, because this is kind of, for me, is where we are talking about the tails. And tails are very difficult to tell how my model fits the tails. Right, so one kind of cuckoo plot is kind of some simple tool that we can apply. And basically what I'm saying is that, based on those inferred probabilities, I'm telling when probability is higher than 1% by 50%, then I assume that this is a stress regime, and I assume that these returns come from stress observation. In this way, I can make two samples, one is normal, and one is kind of stress regime, and then I can look how my model was kind of, I can compare empirical quantas of this distribution against model implied. And I have kind of very good fit to the tails.
May I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
So if you do this filtering, do you do it over the time or you do it only the last time? So I mean, you have observation up to time t, then you filter at t or up to t.
If I understand correctly, up to t. So
from the beginning to the very end.
Yes, you use the same set of parameters.
So you fixed your data observations. You have estimated your parameters.
Yes.
And then you classify every observation, whether it belongs to this one yes. or second state
yes.
based on this rule there.
Yes.
Why do you think this is a good way to do it? It's not.
It's not. Yeah, I know it's not good, but it's just a simple way just to look at the things.
And there are much more better ways to do it. Depends, of course, what are you after. You know,
okay,
what is the
if
base?
You can, if we can talk after the presentation, it would be nice. Nice to hear. Yeah, thank you. So now, so, yeah. So now let's go. So it was the first part of my talk was about, let's say, econometric model for returns. And now let's go to application. So application is a structural default model. And so in these models, we assume random evolution of firm assets, which I denote by A. And each firm issues its debt. So debt is B. And default occurs, like I show in that figure, that like evolution of assets is random, but then something bad happens, it starts going down, and then at the moment that asset value crosses the issued debt, this is default. Then basically the firm is liquidated, and remaining assets are used to pay off the debt. And very important, the notion here is the log distance to default, which is basically the value of firm assets normalized by its debt. And time of default is defined as when x hits zero for the first time. And a very important notion in credit derivatives is credit default swap. So it's to understand this, you consider it like a bond. So bond pays coupons until the kind of firm is alive, right? So you have kind of I have like it's better to just look at the one period model. So I start at time t0. So say in this path, tau default is like is larger than t, right? So here I get my coupon, c. So this will be, in my notations, it will be coupon left. So ct is equal to coupon, and default left is equal to 0. While, so this is non-defaultable class. So same here, across this path, I default. My say tau default is here. So default is when my log distance default becomes negative. So across this path, my coupon leg is 0. This is one period model. And my default leg will be bond recovery. So say, bond loss, so recovery. So in this state I get one. So, and this is a very liquid market, very, very liquid market for majority of major financials and a lot of companies that issue debt. People use it both for speculation and for trading, for kind of hedging existing bond positions, or doing some like trading strategies. So, and CDS spread is very important for a company. What it means is like, say we here. So CDA trade I show like on left scale. So say it's here is 600. It means 6%. It means that at this moment, if I want to refinance my debt, I need to pay to the market 6% above like say treasuries. This is my fund. If say I'm here in this time period right now, it's like slightly around 1%. It means that today it costs me only 1%. So it's very important. And people in finance, within bank finance, they look a lot into this. A lot of companies are leveraged, they need to roll over the debt, and as a matter of fact, the default happens when they are unable to issue new debt. So this is barometer of kind of the CDS rate is kind of barometer of your Helsinki, kind of your well-being.
And obviously it's negatively correlated to stock price. So here I have red line is the stock price. So we see like during financial crisis, stock price was going down, CDS was kind of going up. The same during like some European crisis and the US downgrade. So the question now, how do I value CDS? And the way to understand it, again, as I said, the default happens to when a long distance default becomes hit zero for the first time. But now I can observe the time series of long distance to default and corresponding CDS spread. So if I actually say, if I expect this to be correlated, there must be some kind of regression. If I do some kind of regression, like here, I use scatter plot to predict. So given the observed value of log distance to default, I am looking what is the spread. And here for financial, I observe very strong correlation. Like it's, the model explains very well the CDS. I have R squared like 90%. Don't look much into this kind of parameters of this regression. But it does not always work like that. And in finance, it's known as credit spread puzzle. It basically means that structured model is unable to explain all the variation in CDS spread, especially so for top rated issuers. And they have like different estimates. Like say, basically what they're asking, that market should be kind of say, if market is fair, then kind of when I trade in CDS, on average, kind of the coupon that I pay should be equal to actual realized defaults, right? So that over time, I'm risk neutral in the sense that my realized defaults are equal to implied default. Implied default, obviously, if I have like implied data of this kind of CDS, I can always infer what is the probability that market think I'm going to default this. And so here we have strong for financial stocks and volatile stocks relationship is strong. It's not so strong for like higher rated stocks. And this is kind of what is what I am using is this kind of empirical valuation kernel. So it's especially like I don't know. I hope kind of basically what risk neutral valuation says is that I can't translate econometric time series into prices of kind of tradable securities. That there is no risk premium. That everything hinges on the kind of Gersanov theorem and some kind of complete markets, but it does not in practice. And and for example, like as I said, that in some sense CDS is equivalent to being like a long bond. And so say now if say Deutsche Bank. So say I owe corporate bond of Deutsche Bank, it means that I'm receiving like say 200% basis like interest of say 2%, but say I'm concerned that they're going to default. What I can do, I go into CDS market and I buy protection. And say it's reserves. So now I'm going to pay 2% to protect my bonds against the default of Deutsche Bank. In theory, I should be neutral because if they default, right, I'm going to lose value of my bonds, but the CDS will pay me back this value. In practice, it does not work this way. There's a lot of kind of nuances that basically what is called cash bond CDS spread is known as kind of basis spread. That usually CDS is more liquid, so you have to pay more. So if you want to buy protection, you have to pay more.
And also like a credit spread puzzle, when basically realized defaults unable to explain implied default rate. And so you see we have two situations here. First is econometric model. I already explained how to feed it to time series. And now we need to connect that econometric model to kind of valuation model for CDSs. And I explained that we cannot use parameters of econometric models to price CDSs. We have to come up with kernel, something that can actually incorporate the premium that I observe in the market, discrepancies that observe in the market. And to do so, I'm using this regime switching model, but instead what I'm going to say is that I might insert state. So I'm starting again with the same generator, but now I'm saying that default can occur in two ways. The first is kind of structural, when the firm crosses the default boundary, and the second is kind of random. So now I'm adding kind of third state. Right, so I'm again in this picture, so say 0, 1, say I call it 2. Each time from this I can go here, and also from state 1 I can move here, and I cannot back. It's basically, I have this type of transition matrix. And this is, I interpret this kind of valuation thing. It's basically, it means that I have more probability to default. When I price CDSs, I assume more probability to default than it was empirically observed. So now it's like a little bit of partial differential equations. So basically, we want to value, like we want to value different securities. And obviously, the way to do it efficiently is to look at around the brew regime contingent state prices. And these basically they represent, so now I have like two states. First state is fatal, so I know what everything is default in state 3. But in state 0 and 1, I want to value different securities knowing that I'm in those states. So I want to develop some kind of tools that enable me to make it efficient. And basically, around the brew world, it means that we want to find state contingent prices. And state contingent prices, they resemble the probability density functions. So we now have log distance to default, and I show you some pictures. Basically, what is the state? If say, in this state, what is my price? What is my price of security that say I end up exactly in this state? I'm unable to pinpoint this state. This is give me like this. So in this state, like this price, so they are looking more like kind of density price. I explain what's the difference in a couple of slides. And this state prices, we can use kind of mathematical tools to show that we need to solve coupled partial differential equation. And here I want kind of, so what are we doing here, right? So again, we have choose, so when we default, right? Default occurs when the x, which is the log distance to default, is the boundary, right? And then another one is kind of I'm adding random discounted. So this is kind of killing, what is called in probability, called killing, exponential killing. So my probability density or my state price decreases because I have probability of kind of defaulting due to that alpha. Alpha is probability of going to fatal state, intensity, sorry. And then we have to augment. So basically, once here, I mean, we know basically initial conditions that say I'm in this state, the security pays me 1. The security always pays me like, say, like stock finishes at 100, I get 1. If the stock defaults before that, I get 0. This type of in one dimensional case, this is something that I studied in my kind of master, in my PhD thesis. And now I'm using kind of extending the same tools to solve this kind of couple problem. So now we have couple, and here again, let me maybe to show that. So R0 is basically I have two states. So for each state I'm assigning the price. But what happens when the regime changes? Basically it says that when I start in state 0, because of regime change, my price changes to state 1, right? I have to like incorporate both prices. My kind of say total price depends on prices in both states. And here maybe it's always good to find interpretation. Why, like say in kind of classic diffusion model, around the blue state prices, they correspond to probability density function. Because they integrate to 1. But here it's not so. Here it's like I have different, the price that I paid now depends where I think I'm going to end up in the future, right? So obviously, for each state contains the information. What is actually what my probability of being in that state, in state 0, right? So in this purpose, we have this kind of Kolmogorov equation. So basically, we have now the augmented transition matrix, and we can always calculate probabilities of what is kind of being, me being in that regime. Is there is no structural default, and then, so here is kind of illustration, what I told you. For each kind of x, which is future log distance to default, I'm assigning a price. Price contains both probability of me being in that state and actual like probability being at that state. And when I normalize by this Kolmogorov probabilities, I get something that looks like a density function. And using this, I can price different valuation. I can value like different defaultable securities that depend on the state pricing in this space. So now, maybe I'm going back to econometrics. So now, we need to kind of combine both the kind of econometric model for stock returns and for structural default model. And the way to do it is again, because now my price that I value today, I don't know in what regime I am, right? I can only infer, I can use my model to infer what is the probability of my regime, but I don't know exactly, am I in regime 0 or regime 1? And especially so in time series, I have to kind of maximize my knowledge. What did I know, like across time series, what was the regime? I don't know. So why I take this kind of expected? So when I have like, I apply like my model to value CDS prices across time series, knowing the log distance to default at that time, and also inferring the state probabilities from my econometric model. And yeah, so I wanted, again, very important, what are parameters? What are my parameters? Why I'm doing so? Like in this, so if you remember the original econometric model, we have drift. So empirical valuation kernel, because I'm saying in risk control valuation, the drift don't matter. Because we can hedge the linear risk, can be hedgeable, drift don't matter. While instead of drift, I imagine these alphas. Alphas is probability of jumping into fatal regime, implied by the market. They are not actual. Here drifts are actual, that we actually observe in time series. These alphas are implied. They are implied by the market. And now I apply this kind of procedure. So now I derive this Arrow-Debreu state prices. I can value CDSs. I have econometric model to infer about state probabilities. So now I'm putting everything together. And I'm valuing like model price across the time series. And I'm estimating my model parameters
valuation parameters. So now it's important to understand that I have one is econometric model, another is pricing model, what I call empirical killing. So I'm applying this my model across time series, and it's very good. The fit is very good across different regimes, I mean actual regimes, like during global financial crisis, during kind of this European crisis, model replicates very well time series. And again, if I look at across how my model, given log distance to default, what is my implied kind of CDS rate? And model fits very well the market. And now I can also, because I'm using econometric model for stock price, I also know the inferred probabilities of this kind of of being in kind of regime, in stress regime. I can compare it to the S&P 500, and we obviously we observe kind of strong correlation. So red line is probability for financial stocks, and usually this type of stocks, before the crisis, they were less risky. They were considered as kind of valuable. Like in 2000, we had like air bubble, and a lot of people, like when it busted, a lot of people switched back into kind of value companies. Then obviously, during the global financial crisis, all banks suffered poorly, and why we have kind of some discrepancies, but. Otherwise, we should have very strong correlation between stock and S&P 500 index. And since I know kind of infer probabilities, and if you remember, the histogram of stock returns was very heavy tailed, right? So now I'm not kind of saying doing like much kind of inference here. I'm just what if I kind of use this kind of some simple rule to infer what is my kind of state conditioned returns? Just look at the tails. And tails, my model fits well. It's fit exactly to econometric time series. Right, so in the end, it's two slides left. So maybe it's obviously difficult to digest it, but again, so in the left are parameters for econometric return. You see, econometric model for return, and here are parameters how I value CDS using kind of the model that have kind of the same idea of regime switching, but one is for returns, another one is for CDS. And this is for stock. So again, we see that like regime switching is very evident, right? So our estimate of volatility is 20% for normal state, 85% for abnormal state, right? And we same with return. Only 5% is normal state, but minus 71 is abnormal state. And also probability, like magnitude of jumps, jumps are exponential. So minus 6 is kind of, the mean of jump is minus 6% is kind of very little compared to minus 70% that I see for kind of drift. So the problem kind of, what I found out, and I think is true, that stress regimes are kind of, not only jump, it's more kind of regime change, it's more indicative of stress that we observe in the market rather than pure jumps. And then if we go to valuation, basically for valuation kernel, like regime switches, they have different scales. So obviously 5% is for log distance default is slightly different scale than just for stock returns. But kind of risk neutral valuation or empirical kernel valuation does not really consider kind of regime switching as kind of volatility, as kind of risk factor. For econometric time series, different volatilities in different regimes are my main key risk factor. Whereas for valuation kernel, what turns out to be significant is the probability of going back to fatal regime when I am only in stress test, right? So basically, and this is very easy to interpret. Like, when imagine that you are a company and you want to refinance yourself. But say you want to do it now, it's fine. Everyone is happy, people are risk taking, right? The easy can you can refinance yourself. But then, but if you happen to refinance during turmoil, during like financial crisis, people are risk averse. You have to pay extra premium. And the premium does not actually reflect that you have higher probability of default, no. It's only because liquidity is scarce, people are risk averse. So it has very natural interpretation here that I only observe this risk premium only in that state. And most of this is kind of the summary, like I always want to, like, so now we develop like this, we apply estimation. What next? How are we going to say like present it to decision maker what we actually did? So now let me summarize. So we model the log distance to default. It's observable. It's given the balance sheet data, we can find it log distance to default. We can find it from balance sheet data. So now, and this is kind of was market observable, so we estimated our model based on time series of stock and time series of this log distance to default. So now we have some type of regression, and we assume that there are two states. So the black line is kind of a model-implied CDS rate in bad state, in normal state, and red is in bad state. So now basically, what are we seeing that, okay, say today, log distance is somewhere here, say this point. Now the management, so we do some type of Monte Carlo simulation, so our log distance to default becomes a control variable. So now say management wants to pay dividends, they want to issue new debt, they are going to change the log distance to default. This model is going to show what is associated change in credit default swap rate given this kind of change in default, what is kind of projected. And obviously for companies it's very important the level that they pay on their debt determines the credit rating. Sometimes it's otherwise around, but say like there's a difference that you pay 1% or 2%. And companies say we want to be like B rated, there are all these S&P and Moody's who issue ratings is very important for bond market investors. So basically the model says what kind of bounce that my changes can cause on my rate of funding. And given that say I have bounce, I say that this probability of if you do some changes and the model shows that probability that credit spread will be above 200 basis points is like 10%. So it's not acceptable, right? You have to justify, like you have to show something like this. And what are the bounds that how management should change balance sheet with regards to kind of with a view on how they are going to influence their funding rate. And during this talk, I presented a joint estimation of regime switching model for both econometric time series of return and credit default swaps. Then I showed how to apply Artur Sepp state contingent prices to formally solve the problem. And then I showed like that empirically it's very visible that we need to consider this kind of risk premiums, that there are very strong empirical evidence about the kind of regime changing parameters. And then this is like a paper that I applied to solve this first heated ties. Problem is first heated ties when you have like absorption barrier. And now probably results of this talk will be available soon in my working paper. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you very much for attention. And
thank you.
If you like, have questions, and you who can hesitate to ask them now, please stop by after the talk and ask me.
Thank you. But we cannot ask questions here too. Do we have questions to Artur to comment something? Artur, one actual question is that you have solved a problem in a big bank and you explained to everybody how to solve a bank a problem in the Bank of America, and everybody can learn from that. So life for other banks will be much easier. Is it so, or so they can take your solutions, or please explain that aspect?
It's not problem kind of say coming up with models, right? Problem is how you apply, how you implement, how you estimate it. So, yeah, I mean, you have the slides, but can you able to reproduce it even with paper? Probably it's difficult.
Yeah.
And so this concrete, well, like kind of the idea was to present something for regulators actually. So would be like kind of make it like scientific that because like say. How you convince other people like, that you do math, or like, that this is compatible? Like,
there are several places where you have to choose some practical problems that you didn't say, that you didn't explain all details.
Yes.
The amount of the data, how big is the time interval, for example, and other important places where you have to make a choice between several possibilities. Yes.
But it true that maybe you presenting the results make, if you present it to regulators well enough, you make your competitors' life much harder because they are going to have to explain with the same level of backing explanations.
They compare me to the job.
Okay, that's also true, yes.
Are there some other competitive models also? Or in fact, you think that you have found a really proper way to attack the problem?
It was based on kind of, I started doing everything myself, how what is the best model to kind of model the time series of returns, then how do you value CDSs. And for evaluation of CDSs, there are a lot, like econometric, it's mostly like asset pricing, like that they kind of develop, basically they observe the spread that kind of implied data overestimates the realized data. So there was like in top journals, there was one very interesting paper that they also used to transmission kind of a little bit different approach. The question, yeah, I think this is a realistic model. It's not. It has the right number of parameters. That it's not overcomplicated and it's easier. And what's also like kind of good, it confronts to reality that I have normal state and the stressed state. So obviously you can add maybe something more, but it's not necessary. So just doing kind of like finding the right number of parameters for statistical model is is very important, and especially if you want to make some kind of prediction, not only kind of explain the data, but I want to make predictions. Obviously, I'm very much concerned about how many parameters I have, how I can explain them. So here I can explain almost all parameters, all parameters.
Well, today we have heard about how probabilistic and statistical methods can be used in the back, and it was more or less about risk evaluation. I know Artur's previous work tasks some years ago were quite different, and that when you were dealing with pricing derivatives, and that mathematics is very different from this, and where the partial PDEs, partial derivative equation had to be solved. And this shows that for a quant like Artur, quantitative analyst, the profile of knowledge is very wide. Mm-hmm. In to work in a big bank, you have to know mathematics, statistics, probability. You must be a good programmer also. So, and it's a good motivation for our students to learn. Yeah.
It also let me out that ability also as kind of say mathematicians that you go and work like for kind of corporation. Very important to deliver your ideas. You like people, they not interested in equations apart from this audience, but they interested like figures, like visual, and like it's very important to be able to like explain what is actually model production and how people can utilize it in their for their particular application.
So you have to sell it.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, it seems that we don't have more questions, and let's thank again Artur for this excellent talk. Thank you.